Thank you.
All right.
Karl Hess will give his third talk of the convention, The Management of Liberty. Karl Hess.
Well, this is about actual management in the industrial sense. And a little history on that dismal subject. As you recall, the father of so-called modern management was an asshole named Taylor, who was at an industrial plant and looked out on the shop floor and understood that most of the people on the shop floor knew more about what was going on than he did. And so his great contribution to the 20th century was this invention. The only way for me to know more is for them to know less. And so he invented the modern management notion, which is that a manager needs to restrict the flow of information to everyone else in the project so that he may know more. So consequently, modern management has consisted of people who have become skilled at blocking the flow of information. Because if they know it, no one else does, then they're powerful. If somebody else knows it, they've lost. And that has resulted in the dismal situation that most commentators are familiar with these days, the mismanagement of gigantic corporations like General Motors, and the executive feather bedding by administrators who simply want to hire more administrators to make themselves more important. Well, that sort of dumb management is quite possible. It's a luxury that can be afforded when there's very little competition, which has been true for most of our history, and when there's really, I guess that's the main thing, very little competition. The corporations, of course, are favored immensely by two fairly significant world wars and then some regional wars. They have been buoyed up by that. They've enjoyed incredible subsidies out of general tax funds. The automobile industry, principally, which enjoys the greatest subsidy of any industry, in as much as it has never had to pay for the road system from which it benefits directly. Of course, everybody else has had to pay for it, including people who never use it. And this, despite the fact that a perfectly sensible series of toll roads existed prior to the entry of the public road system into the thing. Now, there's a slight digression there. An example of what happens when a state system supersedes the free market is the road system. And one of its great stultifying effects was that it blocked all new technologies. That is to say, as soon as the dirt roads and other privately owned roads were taken over by the road pavers and the general tax fund situation, the technology was stopped right in its tracks. With four-wheel vehicles, you can imagine what would have happened if the state highway system had not intervened. The thrust of technology would have been toward machines that would have operated more easily on dirt roads, for instance, or on no roads. So there would have the hovercraft immediately comes to mind as an obvious development, and of course helicopters, all sorts of aircraft. Not to mention, for those who are of a fanciful turn of mind, teleportation and such things as that. But state programs stultify and block technology, and so it did. I think much of it is attributable to this notion of modern management, in which, as I say, blocking the flow of information is crucial. One of the great contributions that the computer so-called revolution has made has been the characterological traits of the people involved in it. I commend to anyone who wants to read a really rousing libertarian history by a non-libertarian, to read the book Hackers by Stanley Levy, who's the technology editor of Rolling Stone, so you knew you could count on him. And this book is a story of people who's, beginning with the Model Railroad Club at MIT, whose credo and goal in life was simply to unlock information. They had one enemy, and that was anything that stood in the way of the flow of information. Well, in the face of that, modern management had to start crumbling, I think. But there are many other things that have made modern management subject to change. One of the things is profit. That is to say, companies managed by MBAs and other information blockers have not done quite as well as companies managed by entrepreneurs or companies that are very little managed, as a matter of fact. So that a great development in modern management that is taking place today is demanaging industries and business. That is to say, moving the responsibility for decisions away from a central bureaucracy and down to the active units of production and of activity. Now, the examples range all over the place. I mean, high-tech companies are given to this form of management very easily because it's obvious that in anything that requires swift change, it does not pay to block any information, and it certainly doesn't pay to have a great administrative feather bedding, because the response times are simply too slow, and people's careers depend not on responding quickly to emergencies, but they depend simply on hiring people and on having status, in effect, being part of an institution rather than a process. So the range is very great. Now take, for instance, Dayton Hudson. It is a retailing company, which many of you are familiar with. It has 90,000 employees and a corporate staff of 200. Well, that's a remarkable ratio. And it's based on the Dayton Hudson assumption that most people are honest, have an urge to be creative, and will, if permitted, be responsible for their own actions. And so Dayton Hudson and other companies that manage themselves or demanage themselves in this way, which I offer to you as being essentially libertarian in nature, take the position that policy is not as important as judgment. And this is really is part of a theme, I think, that you've detected in everything I've said over this period, that policy is ideology. Judgment is response to the real world. And I rather like that. And I find that there's now a reflection of it in management. Well, you take other companies. My favorite machine, I suppose, in the whole world, I'll never own one, is the Cray, the great computer. I suppose when some of the Cray 1s are available to surplus, I might have a shot at it. But do you know, come to think of it, with superconducting materials, it is assumed that a Cray, which now, of course, has to be cooled tremendously and is that big, could be made the size of a football. God, what a laptop. But at any rate, Cray, Seymour Cray, who I really think, you know, who is John Galt, people sometimes ask. Hell, he's Seymour Cray, so far as I know. And we should be in touch with such people. We should revere them. Not that we should revere anybody casually, but this man is a powerful force for change in our world. And he once worked for a digital, what's the other one?
Electronics.
Data.
Control data.
Control data. Well, he once worked for there, and I had the unusual experience recently of meeting somebody who had spent some time at Control Data where Cray had once worked, and had then gone up to Cray's place in Wisconsin, where he now works. Incidentally, Cray's first plan, for those of you who are interested in the scale of modern production, Cray's first plant was in a barn on the farm of the home owned by his father. And the hard wiring was done by ladies in the neighborhood. And now he's moved into Milwaukee, I guess it is. And he has a more proper plant, but still, this is the point. This friend of mine went to control data, and he said, as you walked around the hall, everybody was shuffling along, downcast eyes, nobody knew what was going on. Then he went up to Cray, and he said, you could ask the janitor what was going on, and he could tell you. Because Cray's principle of management, and the principle of management of this entire notion of new management is, that what you leadership is setting a goal. And Cray's goal is simple, the most powerful machine in the world. Then, having set the goal, you tell people, well, how about Thursday afternoon? Or something to that effect. And people who are motivated by their desire to do good work do it. They are not interfered with by petty rules and bureaucrats, and they perform well. So nobody tries to block the flow of information. So the janitor is, if hell, a janitor is important when you're trying to get work done. So everybody is important. The greatest genius in the place can be stopped and blocked completely by somebody else failing to do some simple task, throwing away the wrong things, not helping. So that the janitor knows. Well, that's the Cray principle. He's not president of the company at this point, but all of the people there, they take this view. Leadership is goal setting. Performance is personal responsibility. There are many other companies like this. Another company, the name just pops right out of my mind. One of the problems of getting old is that you forget things. But other companies have taken the view that you not only do that, but that you subdivide enterprises, assuming that for very important and particularly high technology work, you simply can't have huge organizations. You've got to know people. There's got to be a creative process that flows throughout the organization, and once it gets too big, you cannot do this. And so they subdivided about 500. I have friends in Illinois who started their own software company, and they subdivided 100, assuming that you just after 100, you've got to have somebody to keep track of the parking spaces, and then the whole thing goes to pot. And so this form of management, which I say is essentially libertarian, is beginning to move throughout the economy. And it's quite clear that no social innovation will ever take place in a bureaucracy. And of course, the great bureaucracies have proven that over time. So the place to look for change are in small, highly productive industrial and technical enterprises. I guess we're all familiar with the fact that the major steel companies in this country, dumb, brute big, idiotic companies, are out of the steel business pretty effectively, but that the mini mills, so-called mini mills in this country, are all making money hand over fist. And one of the curious side effects of mini mills is that part of the technology involves using electric melters, which are much less polluting than the old coke-fired systems. So what? It is almost inevitable that the better in technology is defined as the most efficient uses of energy. One of the efficient uses of energy is not to have effluence. A waste is a misplaced resource. An ideal industrial operation would have zero waste. It would use everything. In China, and it seems sad that we have to learn sometimes from heathens, but nonetheless, it's a possibility. In China, one of the first movements in that country toward the free market involved the handling of waste. That is to say, in a factory, if workers could figure out a use for the waste product, it was given to them and they could, in effect, go into business for themselves. It would be tremendously useful, of course, for any American a corporation to follow the same line. It certainly costs a lot less money than buying landfill space. But at any rate, that's the principle of management is individual responsibility of this new management. The publisher of my upcoming book, plug, which is called Capitalism for Kids, It's written for 10-year-olds because I'm, although you may find this an ungracious remark, I'm not convinced that it's worth talking to anybody much over 10 anymore. I cherish libertarians because they manage to act like 10-year-olds often enough to qualify. But at any rate, the publisher is Ted Nicholas Peterson, and his publishing company is based on this notion. He says, I try to make everybody in the company feel that they're in business for themselves, that they bear responsibility for their actions, and that they will share both in the bad times and the good times. Well, I think that's fine. Very libertarian. Many libertarians have been catapulted into the movement, of course, from an admiration of old industry. And I must say, out of the romantic view of old industry that some very important philosophers have had. Karl Marx and Ayn Rand, to mention two. And the view of the old industry with some heroic figure standing at the top of it, running it, has made people think that there are great economies of scale in this sort of thing, and that all you have to do is have a hard manager telling everybody what to do, and you have to assume that everybody else is stupid and somehow subhuman and subnormal, and then you get great things done. Well, there may have been a time when there was some justification for this observation, but certainly not in the electronics age. All of that has changed. All of it's changed. There will never again, in an advanced industrial company, a country, be another River Rouge. That sort of production is moving now to the third world, where it may be an appropriate stepping stone. As I mentioned the other day, the advanced industrial nations today mean advanced. That is, they have moved well beyond massive factory production and now face the responsibility, it seems to me, of staying solvent by doing highly customized work. I mean, how in the world? It may be that most automobiles of the mass production variety, as I've been saying, would be better produced in Korea. The wage rates are probably more suitable to mass production. But that doesn't mean that America just suddenly stops producing things. It means that they start producing their own 50 versions of the Rolls Royce. And incidentally, Rolls Royce is a fairly convincing tribute to the fact that a lot of people would rather have a cottage industry automobile than a mass-produced one. Now people say, oh, but it costs so much. It doesn't cost much at all. It's a cheap automobile. Because you buy one Rolls Royce for $140,000 and hand it on to your children. During which time your neighbor has bought how many $17,000 Chevrolets? Well, you know, it's a credit problem. If you could get proper financing, it would be the
mortgage your house.
Well, it could be, but I mean, all of these things. And then there's the possibility, what would a Rolls Royce without leather and without custom woodwork be like? How much could you sell it for? Suppose you rebuilt the Model T Ford today and sold it to people who wanted a high ground clearance and a cheap car. Suppose. All of these things are in the realm of possibility for cybernated machine shops. I know of one libertarian who's a state chairman, as a matter of fact, who is the proprietor of a very advanced and cybernated machine shop. And the freedom that gives to this person is immense. Because among other things, he can trade in the world market beyond a lot of controls. That is to say, if your own small-scale self-managed, self-contained manufacturing unit, your freedom to trade in the world is greatly enhanced because, in effect, we think always of smuggling diamonds and gold. But, of course, that's not all that is smuggled in the world past the cruel barriers of the customs people. People smuggle tools, very usefully in the world. And every time someone, and I would hope that many of them would be libertarians, every time someone breaks past a barrier and trades directly with somebody else, they've struck a real blow for freedom. Every time a tool is transferred to someone who can use it productively, a blow is struck for freedom and against oppression, and certainly against state barriers. And this is also useful, it seems to me. Well, back to management, let me quote something. This is, I mentioned earlier that it's a good deal better to be lucky than smart. I base my career on that. And if just by luck, someone said, did you read the current issue of Success magazine? I hadn't, and so there was one copy left. Luck again. And here's a magazine devoted to entrepreneurial activities that seems to have the word libertarian on virtually every single page. Just to cite you some things. Here's a young lady who, among other things, is absolutely gorgeous, come to think of it. And she's 21 years old. She has her own fashion design business. And here's the first description of her. She was a perfect, if extreme, example of the libertarian political philosophy. Unfettered capitalism combined with a purely personal definition of morality in which everything is okay as long as it doesn't hurt someone else. Well, isn't that something? And it goes on. It mentions her reading habits include the Fountainhead. She read when she was 14. And next page is a discussion of success readers as a group. These are entrepreneurs, generally. And incidentally, that's something that seems to me terribly important. If libertarianism is entrepreneurism, really, because it suggests that people individually can change things, can work on their own behalf, and that they can be fair in dealing with people. And so here's success readers as a group, their characteristics and all. Down toward the end, it said, readers defied easy stereotyping, but on the grounds that libertarianism is often associated with personal idealism, 77% of the respondents received perfect or near perfect libertarian scores. Here's a magazine. Are they on the mailing list? I don't recall any such thing. Should they be? Absolutely. We have so often turned our eyes to political magazines and felt that that because we're a political party, that's all we should be doing. Not so. Not so. We're a political party that believes in economic liberty and individual liberty. And so do these folks. And so they should be natural allies, whether they ever have time enough to involve themselves in politics or not. It's wonderful to see this. It just could be, you see, that the way things develop could be like this, that this entire management thing that I'm talking about brings a wave of libertarianism into the most productive industries in the country, the most productive businesses. At the same time, the Libertarian Party knocks on the doors of politics everywhere and keeps reminding people that there is an alternative and that there is a force that stands in the way of prosperity and that sort of thing. And this is all necessary. Everything that it can be done should be done. The notion that there is one way to salvation, one gimmick that will do it, any single device is so silly. You wouldn't say that of any other facet of your life. You wouldn't say that you'd be one can opener and all of your can problems are solved forever. One car and that's all that's ever done. One anything. Nobody has one anything to solve their problems. One tool, you know what happens to combination tools. You buy something that says that it will unscrew things, unbolt them, saw them, whack them, and what happens? Lasts for one time. It's cute to look at, it's very clever, and you can use it once. What you need are all of the tools, and we need all of the tools. One of the tools is this. If you have a business today, you should use that business to create libertarians as much as to create profits, I believe, if you want to. And how can you do that? Fire everybody on the premises who's a real goon. I mean, if a person won't assume responsibility for their actions, get rid of them. Say there's no room here for spectators. Either you're going to be a partner in this enterprise or out. Well, now, don't forget that means something for you, too. You've got to be prepared to share. That is to say, if people are doing part of the work, I think you need to get out of the old mindset that they are somehow your personal slaves, because it's getting less and less true. People are becoming skilled and mobile, and the days of loyal employees, thank goodness, are over. Nothing is more sad than the notion of a loyal employee. You want somebody who is good enough for somebody else to want. It's like in West Virginia. People say if young women aren't good enough for their kinfolk, they're... I live in West Virginia, so I can talk like that. But at any rate, I believe this is true. What you need are people who are good at what they do and who will share the responsibility. And it seems to me that libertarians need to get used to the idea that sometimes enterprises are very mutual in nature. And just because you had a good idea doesn't mean that you can produce it all by yourself. If you can produce it all by yourself, you should produce it all by yourself. If you can't and you require other people to work with you, the other people, it seems to me, if you're interested in promulgating a libertarian attitude, should be equal partners in the enterprise. They should share in responsibility. It's another way to spread libertarianism, I believe. Well, just another observation on the way it's going, it seems to me. In writing this book, Capitalism for Kids, I'd like to mention some of the kids I met, because they're really so exciting. The popular notion is that a kid who goes to work early, and particularly one who likes to get something accomplished, is going to end up like that dreadful, silly person on television that Michael Fox plays. Isn't that his name?
Yeah.
Well, that's just absurd. You know, that kid's going to be a pot. You know he's going to go into politics eventually. I mean, his hero is not Boone Pickens or some other great man. His hero is Ronald Reagan, whose contribution to industrial technology is slight. So at any rate, the kids I met are kids like this. Completely unlike that. I met a 17-year-old in Wichita, Kansas, who's got three successful businesses going at the moment. And he casually mentioned that he thought he would buy a franchise just as his pension. He thought he'd buy his pension early. And I think that showed a good casual attitude. He wants to go to college, but not for credit. He's always been interested in Greek literature, so he thinks he'll go and study that. And now he's rich enough to do it on his own terms. In other words, he's understood that the university is a resource and that credentials are, if you take them seriously, it's because you're going into a business that takes them seriously, and you should watch out for such a business. So, my favorite trio, I think, were siblings of 8, 9, and 10. They had wanted to go to Disneyland. And because they had some decent upbringing at home, they didn't apply for a grant from the Endowment for the Humanities. They thought they'd have to work for it. I'm sure that they're being brought up by their mother. I'm sure that she was ostracized by the local Be Kind to Children people, who do not think that children should ever work, which means that they think children are not capable of it, which means they think kids are stupid, which shows a really, I think, a very... an unhealthy attitude toward children. These kids decided to work for it. They set up a recycling business, and this was about 2 years ago. And they haven't gone to Disneyland yet because they're entirely too busy. They presented me with their business cards. And they told me about some of their tax problems. 8, 9, and 10. And now, were these kids, you know, sort of shriveled up, grim little monsters? No, they were happy and rollicking and having a great good time. And they'll be so healthy from now on because they can afford good dental care. And they can vacation in the south of France and other healthy places. And they're just wonderful. And all of the kids, I met kids, one kid said, I mean, he's about 15. He said, I was trying to figure out, he said, I like to do two things. I like rock music and I love to talk on the telephone. I mean, I don't understand the combination, but it's his. And so I said, how can I make a buck out of this? So he could do it all the time. So I got this idea. I'll become an entrepreneur booking rock bands into social events and disc jockeys. So he's on the phone all day, getting in touch with rock bands and people with social events and doing exactly what he said. And he said, also, he was so cute. He was talking to a group and he had a beeper. He pulled the beeper out, 15 years old. And he pulled the beeper out and he said, to a bunch of other kids. He said, see this? That little gadget made me $10,000 last year because he got things that he would have otherwise missed. Now, was he grim and, you know, was he a money grubber? No, he's a happy kid doing something, doing good for other people. Doing good in the free market always does good for other people. Otherwise, you go broke. So I was so encouraged by this. I'm so enthused that writing the book was a great pleasure. And I hope to meet so many more kids like that. Now, do they lack charity? Absolutely not, because that's all they have to help people. They haven't even thought about the idea of instituting a new welfare program. I mean, their healthy notion of life is simply that when your neighbor needs help, you help your neighbor. That's simple. It's a very decent impulse. Most people have it. Charity has been knocked so much lately. I find that distressing. But I think it's coming back in style because it works and welfare doesn't. Well, I guess the upshot of this is just an extension of what I was saying about tools. All of the tools today. I didn't mention that quite as specifically. The characteristics of all of modern technology, the central characteristics are two. Decentralization and miniaturization. Those are the characteristics of everything you find interesting. Things get smaller and things get useful in decentralized conditions. Of everything goes in this direction. Well, is there a better description of the environment of liberty, as a matter of fact? To be able to do things where you want, as you wish to, decentralization, and also miniaturization. I think it's the tools are good, the management forms are good, they're there, things are beginning to change, and to change at the upper levels, too. You know, not just... It's not just hippie entrepreneurs like Seymour Cray who've come up with this sort of thing, or Steve Wozniak. It's people like Ross Perot who can be accused of virtually anything else in the world, but certainly not of being a hippie. And yet he has exactly this interpretation. And the reason that General Motors bought him out for a fairly tidy sum was that he was telling General Motors it had too many managers, they were stupid, you don't need a lot of MBAs. Running around, screwing up things. You need people who know what they're doing. Do you remember, come to think of it, I think GM is one of my absolute pet peeves in this whole world. The difference between it and the Ministry of Auto Cars in the Soviet Union is language. John DeLorean's book, On a Clear Day You Can See GM, has in it the remarkable incident in which DeLorean is promoted to head of the Pontiac division, as I recall, a fairly responsible position to be president of a motor car company. And so what does the board of directors tell him to do? Wear a necktie. Well, he could see the writing on the wall at that point. But DeLorean, whose business practices in later years don't commend themselves to me, going into business with the Irish government was a terrible mistake. But he said early on, he was an engineer, and he said that he had admired the fact that craftsmen in the shop would, if they were displeased with the way things were going, would simply put their tools in their box, close the box, and leave. And he said he determined at that time that even if he rose in management ranks, that he would always be prepared to put his tools in his box, close it up, bid goodbye to the idiots, and go on, which is roughly what he did. I think any libertarian, wherever they are, they're working for somebody else, or whatever they're doing, should be prepared to do that whenever something encroaches on their individual liberty. It's one way to leave, is to leave, simply leave. Well, or we could manufacture a better tape, I suppose. In conclusion, I've talked very often about the benefits, I believe, of libertarians who are producers, material producers, who manufacture things, who sell things. And I would say that this includes poets, as a matter of fact, that it's really important for them to keep in much closer touch than they have, and certainly to do more business with one another, if they can. I don't suggest losing money just to do business with a libertarian, but if all other things being equal, wouldn't it be a bit nicer to do it? If you knew who they were, if you knew what supplies they could provide, what talents they had, it seems to me it would be better to deal with them. And it also would be a good way to test their libertarian principles, because I'm sure we're all sick to death of libertarians who talk about individual responsibility and then don't pay their bills. And it's good to find out about such people. And I will tell you this, I don't care if a person swears on the collected work of Ayn Rand that they believe in liberty. If they do not pay their bills, I'd say, horse shit. You can have an absolutely perfect philosophy and be a dishonest person. I would prefer a dishonest or an honest person who had an evolving or not fully developed philosophical position than the one who could quote me chapter and verse from every libertarian tome and still didn't pay their bills. So there's that. What else is there? I don't know what else there is. Are there any comments or questions? Yeah.
Is it possible to reserve a few copies of this book when it comes in?
Oh, I hope not. I expect every... Now, Tatanka, I want you to read this book. I want you to sell them Hopis everything you can get. I don't know. I don't know how they're going to distribute the thing. Ted Nicholas Peterson has... he built his publishing empire on books like How to Avoid Probate and all that sort of stuff, and I don't know how they do it, but I admire him, and I think that he'll do well, and I hope the book makes a lot of money. It won't make money for me. I'm not the contractor. I just wrote it. It's contracted with a little corporation somewhere in West Virginia, and it'll be out in the fall, I guess. Somebody, I was going to mention the thing that occurred to me, and I didn't get around to saying, was that I have heard while here, while talking to someone, a person develop an authentically good and obviously, I think, has a good chance of being wildly profitable entrepreneurial idea. That's very important for libertarian media. There should be a segment of such gatherings. Even though we're here to talk politics, we should also understand that it's good to talk about this other business. If you can think of a new business, these are the people you should go in business with. And so I had this experience of someone, we were talking and a good, really good idea came up, Another one came up. This first one is proprietary, and I can't mention what it is, but the second one I'm sure is public in nature, and I just throw it out. We had talked earlier about the wonderful conviviality of children and computers, and someone made the very sensible suggestion, would a private school, based on the notion that elementary school, that every child there would have their own computer, and that the first part of the process would be learning logo, and then going on into logic and so forth, wouldn't that be a potentially attractive school? Well, I think there's something to be looked into along those lines. And as a libertarian activity, it has wonderful implications. Intelligent children are our hope for the future. Opposing state school, government schools is our hope for the present, future, everything. And making money is the way you can afford to do these things. So here, possibly, is an idea for a private school that would be very useful. I intend to try it if I possibly can. So, any other? Yeah.
Do you think of the concept that some corporations are into the dual ladder of innovators versus the organization?
I don't know about it. Sounds interesting. I can't imagine. I think a corporation that admits that it has a lot of non-creative people on hand is in trouble, you see, because a non-creative...
The problem is the other way around. A lot of creative people are not very good at organizational, social, and...
Oh, you mean like being a retail clerks?
Well, no.
Oh, I see. Yeah. So you really need several kinds of entrepreneurs, but certainly a dumb salesman is as dangerous as a dumb chemist. That is, they both should be creative. I mean, it is not necessary to be a chemist to be creative. And I think as a rule of thumb, I would say that a corporation that has had, not knowing too much about it, this is a reckless interpretation, but I would say that a corporation that says that it has some non-creative people on hand and has a track for them would be well advised to get them out of the business. That if a person is non-creative, they not only can be, but should be replaced by a machine. Machines do it much better. Non-creative people should be available, I suppose, as a pool of house servants, and that sort of thing, but not working with important tools, because machines can do it so much better. Human beings working with tools are justified in doing it only if they display all of the attributes of a human being. Creativity, response to emergencies, flexibility, creativity, all of these things. Otherwise, a machine is much more decent to have a machine there. Anything that a machine can do, it should do. If a machine can do it, a person probably shouldn't do it because it's boring and silly. And there's so many other things. You know that, and people say, well, what do all of these non-creative people do? I don't know how many non-creative people there are in the world. We've never tested this thing because we don't give people a chance. You look at the very poorest neighborhoods and you say, well, what would happen to all of those poor people? I can tell you what would happen. If you took the poorest neighborhood in the densest city in the United States of America and you said, zap, you're a free market zone, there would be wealth created within the weekend. People would start doing things. But what happens if you're a poor person in a poor neighborhood and you want to start feeding people? You can't do it from the back of a station wagon. You can't do it in a basement. You can't do it on a push cart. You can't do it the way anybody used to be able to do it. You have to have stainless steel kitchen equipment. You have to bribe the building inspectors. You have to bribe everybody. The cost of getting into business is horrendous. And they say, oh, well, see, that means these people are stupid. You know, they have no ambition. They turn to crime. My God, I'd turn to crime, too. If I had to bribe 15 building inspectors, it'd be easier to go rob from them. People get these lessons, so that's what I mean. Creativity is, we haven't tested it, people don't know much about it, And there may be some people who simply can't do much, and there's always been a niche for such people, usually in domestic service or in, running elevators. Or what?
They run elevators in the Capitol building.
Well, that's the other. Exactly, but who runs elevators in the Capitol building? Undergraduates, graduate students, friends of senators, people who are sitting there reading their political science textbooks while you pay for them to turn the crank from right to left, from fore to aft. And do you pay them well? Ho, ho, ho. I mean, they don't get the wages that people get in inner city ghettos. I mean, these people are really doing fine. Oh, my. Mm. Yeah, oh, I'm sorry.
How do you balance responsibility against a corporation given the assumption that one of the goals of incorporating is responsibility avoidance?
Well, I think that's something that libertarians need to think about. I understand all of the interesting defenses that Nozick and others have for the corporation, but I would say that's inherently an anti-libertarian notion to defend anybody from liability. It's a distortion of the free market. Unless a person is perfectly liable, how can they be perfectly responsible? And so I think it's something to think about. All of us have corporations, I'm sure, but that's like being in politics. It's a defensive measure. It's a way to defend yourself, but it's not desirable, and it should be on the libertarian agenda to first question, and possibly later to attack corporate law on the same basis that the Price-Anderson Act has been attacked by libertarians. Well, I guess we're through for this segment.